Hello students, welcome back again in virtual classroom. Today we are learning the second part of lesson number 1.5, Mrs. Addis, written by Sheila K. Smith. K. Smith's Mrs. Addis tells the story of a peasant woman who agrees to hide a desperate young man who comes to her house begging for protection. He has been caught poaching on the nearby estate and in panic killed one of the keepers. Knowing that her son was a childhood friend of the fugitive, the woman takes him in and does not betray him. Even when she discovers that the man has killed was her own son. Now students, in the earlier part, we have studied information given in the lesson up to page number 46. Now we are going to study the upcoming information which is given in the lesson. So now let's try to find out what happened next. For a moment, his poor heart nearly choked him with its beating. They were the keepers. They had guessed he was with Mrs. Addis, his old friend's mother. He had been a fool to come to the cottage. Nearly losing his self-control, he shrank into the corner, shivering, half sobbing. But the footsteps went by. The next minute, Mrs. Addis stuck her head into the shade. Now, Mrs. Addis replied that, "You are not that much good friend of Tom, I suppose, but Tom has a very good friend to you. So I will help you only because of Tom's sake." That is what Mrs. Addis told to the Peter Crouch. Then Mrs. Addis stuck her head into the shade and assured Peter Crouch that the keepers went by carrying lanterns in hand. She encouraged him that it would be better if Peter slipped out now, means very first, and can wait Canceron. After that, Peter Crouch again felt very much shivering. He was half sobbing. Till now the footsteps went by. He was in a state of shock because what have he done? He was also not sure about that. "That was the keepers," she said shortly. "I saw them go by. They had lanterns. Maybe it would be better if you slipped out now and went towards Canceron. You would miss them that way and get over to Kent. There is a London train that comes from Tunbridge Wells at 10 tonight." "That would be a fine thing for me, ma'am, but I haven't the price of ticket on me." Now Mrs. Addis insisted Peter Crouch to went to Canceron. Canceron is the name of town where there is a station. She asked him to go there to avoid guards because they were in search for him. And she informed that there is a London train comes from Tunbridge Wells to 10 o'clock. And better Peter leave this place for his safety. Now Peter Crouch said that it would be a fine thing, but I don't even have money to go. Hearing this, Mrs. Addis went to the drawers and bought 7 shillings. Chalice means British coins, and gave that amount to Peter Crouch as train fare of London. She also gave bit over some extra amount to Peter Crouch apart from train fare. She went to one of the kitchen drawers. "Here is 7 shillings. It will be your fare to London and a bit over." For a moment he did not speak. Then he said, "I don't know how to thank you, ma'am." "Oh, you needn't thank me. I'm doing it for Tom. I hope you won't get into trouble because of this." "There isn't much fear. No one's ever likely to know you have been in this cottage. That's why I would sooner you went before Tom came back. For maybe he would bring a friend before Tom came back. For maybe he would bring a friend with him, and that would make trouble." She opened the door for him, but on the threshold they both stood still, for again footsteps could be heard approaching, this time from the far south. "Maybe it's Tom," said Mrs. Addis. "There is more than one man there, and I can hear voices." "You would better go back," she said shortly. "Wait till they have passed, anyway." With an unwilling shrug, he went back into the little dusty shed which he had come to hate, and she locked the door upon him. Now, Peter Crouch was very happy to receive that amount and said that, "I don't know how to thank you, ma'am," to Mrs. Addis. "I don't know the words of gratitude for you, Mrs. Addis." That is what Peter Crouch told her. Mrs. Addis told him, "You may not thank me, Peter, because I am doing this for Tom. Tom loves you as his friend, and I don't want you to be in trouble. I want your safety. Now no one should know you are in this cottage. That's why I am in a hurry to send you before Tom's return to home. If Tom brings any friend from the farm where he works with him, it would be very difficult for me to tackle the situation. Better you leave this place and go as early as possible then." Mrs. Addis opened the door for him to go, but on the doorstep they both stood still. You know why? They both heard of some footsteps again nearby the cottage, which were coming from the south. Mrs. Addis thought that the footsteps might be of Tom, her son. "This more than one man, and I can hear voices. Peter, you would better go back," she asked Peter. "Wait there till they pass this road. Be inside the shed." Unwillingly, Peter went back into the little dusty shed. Mrs. Addis locked it from outside. Now, students, come to the page number 48. The footsteps drew nearer. They came slowly and heavily this time. For a moment he thought they would pass also, but their momentary dulling was only the crossing of the strip of grass outside the door. The next minute there was a knock. It was not Tom then. Mrs. Addis understood this knock is not made by Tom, because as a mother she knows the sound how Tom knocks at the door. What happened to Peter Crouch now? Hearing the knock at the door, you know, there was a knock at the door, and again Peter Crouch was fearful. He was trembling with anxiety and curiosity. what would happen to him. He fixed his eye on one of the cracks in the door. He saw a man into the cottage. Who was that man? Let's find it out. Trembling with anxiety and curiosity, Peter Crouch put his eye to one of the numerous cracks in the door and looked through into the kitchen. He saw Mrs. Addis go to the cottage door, but before she could open it, a man came in quickly and shut it behind him. Now, Peter Crouch saw from one of the crack of the door a man into the cottage. The man quickly shut the door behind him. He identified that man, who he was. Crouch recognized Whittler, one of the keepers of Scotney Castle, and he felt his hands and feet grow leaden cold. They knew where he was then. They had followed him. They had guessed that he had taken refuge with Mrs. Addis. It was all up. He was not really hidden. There was no place for him to hide. Directly they opened the inner door, they would see him. Why couldn't he think of these things better? Why wasn't he cleverer at looking after himself? Like other men, his legs suddenly refused to support him and he sat down on the pile of sacks. Now Peter Crouch recognized that man. He was Whittler. Whittler, one of the guards of Scotney Castle, a fort nearby the jungle. He felt very nervous. His hands and feet began to be cold. They must have traced him now, he thought. They had followed him correctly, he thought. This rightly guess by the guards were absolutely right. They rightly had guessed that he had taken shelter in the cottage of Mrs. Addis. So many thoughts came to him. He began to blame him. Why he come to Mrs. Addis's cottage? Why wasn't it intelligent enough to look after himself? His legs were shaking in nervousness. He sat down only on the pile of sacks in the dusty shed. The man in the kitchen seemed to have some difficulty in saying what he wanted to Mrs. Addis. He stood before her silently, twisting his cap. "Well, what is it?" she asked. "I want to speak to you, ma'am," said Whittler. Now, the man is Whittler, a keeper, a guard of Scotney Castle, and stood before Mrs. Addis, silently twisting his cap over his head. He was hesitating to speak and felt difficulty to speak to Mrs. Addis. Mrs. Addis asked him, "Well, what is it? What is the reason of your arrival here in this night, Whittler?" asked Mrs. Addis to Whittler. Peter Crouch listened, straining his ear, for his thudding heart nearly drowned the voices in the next room. Oh no, he was sure she would not give him away, if only for Tom's sake. She was a good sort, Mrs. Addis. "Well," she said sharply, as the man remained tongue-tied, "I have brought you bad news, ma'am." Here, tongue-tied means speechless. Whittler said, "Madam, I want to speak to you." Peter Crouch was hearing the conversations from inside the shed. His heartbeats thudding is sounding very loudly in fear of being caught up by him, but he was confident of Mrs. Addis that he was sure Mrs. Addis must not reveal them about his destination, about his stay in her house, because of Tom's friendship with him. Mrs. Addis was very good to know about this man's mind, but the man remained tongue-tied, means speechless. Her expression changed. "What? It isn't Tom, is it?" "He's outside," said the keeper. "What do you mean?" said Mrs. Addis, and she moved the door. "Don't, ma'am. Not till I have told you."
"Told me what?"
"Oh, be quick, man, for mercy's sake." And she tried to push past him to the door. Now, Widlow said to Mrs. Addis that he had brought a bad news for her. Mrs. Addis was tensed up.
"Bad news? What is it? What the bad news? Tell me. It is not about my Tom's son, Tom.
No, is it?" Widlow said, "He is outside."
"What do you mean?" said Mrs. Addis, and she moved the door.
Widlow said, "Please, madam, do not go out now." Mrs. Addis appealed to him, "Please tell me what the bad news is." She pushed him to the door to see outside. "There has been a row," he said, down by Cinderwood. "There was a chap there snaring rabbits, and Tom was walking with the Boormans and me and old Crotch. We heard a noise, and there it was too dark to see who it was, and directly he saw us he made off, but we would scared him and he let fly with his gun."
"Tom," said Mrs. Addis. The keeper had forgotten his guard, and before he could prevent her, she had flung open the door. The men outside had evidently been waiting for the signal, and they came in carrying something, which they put down in the middle of the kitchen floor.
"Is he dead?" asked Mrs. Addis without tears. The men nodded. They could not find a dry voice like hers. In the shed, Peter Crouch had ceased to sweat and tremble. Strength had come with despair, for he knew he must despair now. Besides, he no longer wanted to escape from this thing that he had done. "Oh, Tom, and I was thinking it was one of the keepers. Oh, Tom." "Now," Widler said, "that I was walking with Boorman's madam. Old Crotch was with us in the Cinderwood forest, and Tom was also with us. There was a chap, a man, who was there, who was trying to catch rabbits in the wood. We were chasing him. Suddenly, we heard noise. It was a very quick, dark night. We could not identify the person. We couldn't see the man. We could not catch him. He ran away quickly. We scared him. He left his gun in fear. In the shed, Peter Crouch had overheard everything, the conversation which was going between Mrs. Addis and the keepers. After that, Mrs. Addis literally screamed. "Is he dead?" asked Mrs. Addis without tears. Now, the voice which was created by Mrs. Addis was really very much emotionless. The man nodded yes. Mrs. Addis screamed out, "Tom!" She opened the door. Very first, the men outside waiting. They came in carrying something they had put down in the middle of the kitchen floor. Mrs. Addis saw her son, her loving son. Now she is without tears. She asked, "Is he dead?" The man nodded, "Yes." This time Peter Crouch overheard all the words. What had the old piece of conversations? He stopped to show it and trembled due to nervousness. He began to regret for his work. He felt ashamed of his wrong deed. He himself did not know it. It was Tom who he shot at. He began to repent. "Oh, Tom, I was thinking it was one of the keepers. Oh, Tom, I did this to you, my friend, my lovely friend, and it was you that got it from me. I don't want to leave." Now, Peter Crouch was in deep sorrow. "And it was you that got it from me. I don't want to leave." That is what Peter Crouch said to himself. He was in a deep sorrow, knowing about his loving friend's demise. He lost his wish to live anymore. And yet, life was sweet, for there was a woman at Ticehurst, a woman as faithful to him as Tom, who would go with him to the world's end even now. But he must not think of her. He had no right. He must pay with his life for what he had done. Now, students, a lady loved Peter Crouch very much. And this lady could also sacrifice for him. And she was very faithful, pretty trustworthy. And Peter Crouch was very sad and full of repentance for his wrong deed. He's thinking that he has no right to live in comfort and must pay with his life for what he had done. He became very negative. Peter Crouch felt very sad for Mrs. Addis, this loving mother. Mrs. Addis was sitting in the old basket armchair by the fire. One of the men had helped her into it. "We'll go round to Ironlatch Cottage and ask Mrs. Gain to come down to you. This is a terrible thing to have come to you. And as for the man who did it, we have a middling good guess who he is. And he shall hang. We didn't see his face, but we have got his gun." He threw it into a bush where he bolted, and I swear that gun belongs to Peter Crouch, who's been up to no good since the day he was sacked for stealing corn. Mrs. Addis was living in her cottage with her son Tom. Tom is being killed by Peter Crouch. Peter Crouch was very sad. Students, try to feel the pain of this mother. Try to feel her sufferings. This mother lost her only son. One of the men helped Mrs. Addis to sit into the old armchair by the fire. She is without tears. She has turned into stone. She is overwhelmed with sorrows for her loving son. The people thought of calling Mrs. Gain, a lady from Iron Ledge Cottage, to come down to Mrs. Addis to give her company in her mournful state, in her distress. Now, Mrs. Addis was in a state of shock. All the men, all the keepers, all the guards thought that someone should console Mrs. Addis. The keeper said, "We know, madam, this is a terrible shock for you. It is an unbearable shock for you. We have a good guess who the man is, and he shall hang. He will be hanged for his offense, for this he commits a severe crime. We did not see this man's face. It's right, but we have got his gun. He threw it into a bush while escaping. That gun belongs to Peter Crouch." Now, students, turn over page number 50. But he couldn't have known it was Tom when he did it. He and Tom always being better friends than he deserved. Peter Crouch was standing upright now, looking through the crack of the door. He saw Mrs. Addis struggle to her feet and stand by the table, looking down on the dead man's face. He saw her put her hand into her apron pocket where she had thrust the key of the shed. Now, Mrs. Addis, what is being done by her now? It is noticed by Peter Crouch from the cracks of the wall. Peter Crouch saw Mrs. Addis was trying to stand, looking down on the dead son's face painfully. He saw her put her hand into her apron pocket where she kept the key of the shed. "The Boermans have gone after Crouch," said Whittler, nervously breaking the silence. "They would thought he would broken through the wood iron latch way. There is no chance of this having been by here. You haven't seen him tonight, ma'am." There was a pause. "No," said Mrs. Addis. "I haven't seen him, not since Tuesday." She took her hand out of her apron's pocket. Now Whittler broke the silence nervously and told her the Boermans went to search for Peter Crouch outside. "Madam, you haven't seen him tonight, have you?" Mrs. Addis nodded, wanted to mean no. She requested the men to carry her son to the bedroom door. The men picked up the stretcher and carried Tom's dead body into the next room. Then silently, she wrung the mother by the hand. They held her hand together and twisted them in a way that expressed her deep concern about her when they could not change the situation. These persons went silently. "Well, we will be getting around and fetch Mrs. Gain. Reckon you would be glad to have her." Mrs. Addis nodded. "Will you carry him in there first?" And she pointed to the bedroom door. The men picked up the stretcher and carried it into the next room. They silently each wrung the mother by the hand and went away. She waited until they had shut the door. Then she came towards the shed. Crouch once more fell a shivering. He couldn't bear it. No. He would rather be hanged than face Mrs. Addis. He heard the key turn
in the lock and he nearly screamed. Now Mrs. Addis waited till they went and shut the door. Then she came towards the shed. Peter crouched once more, feel shivering. But this shivering is due to sorrow, due to pain, due to his guilt. Due to his guilt conscience. How to show his face to this mother? Rather to be hanged than face Mrs. Addis, he thought. Mrs. Addis unlocked the shed. She did not come in. She just unlocked the door from outside, then crossed the kitchen with a heavy dragging, means tired footsteps, and shut herself in the room where her dead son was lying. Now, students, last paragraph. Peter Crouch knew what he must do. The only thing she wanted him to do, the only thing he could possibly do, he opened the door and silently went out. Peter Crouch could not talk to Mrs. Addis. He opened the door and silently went out of the cottage with lots of sorrow. He went out with the expression of the gratitude. He went out with the expression of gratefulness, with the message of thanks. He went out of the cottage. Students, this is the tragic end of the story. A mother lost her son, her only son, and gave safety to the killer of the son. Students, this is the tragic end of the story. This is the story of a kind mother who knows to forgive. This is the story of her kindness. This is the story of a noble mother who knows to bear her grief, stricken heart. This is the story of a great mother who knows to love her child truly. Regards to all the mothers on the earth. Students, remember, forgiveness is an attribute, a great quality of human beings. And remember, forgiveness provides opportunity to change the behavior. Thank you for your patient hearing. See you with a new video. Till then, bye. Have a nice time.